You know, sometimes our lives get so hectic that we forget that we need to slow down and allow God to do His work through us and not us do it for Him. All the time when we think about the times that you get busy running to and from every place, always kind of feel like that Dunkin' Donuts man when I was a little kid and watched the Dunkin' Donuts commercial. Remember that commercial where he was beating himself coming and going? Well, many times we feel like that. And so what you're going to see over the next little while is our effort to fulfill the vision that God has given us without becoming the Dunkin' Donuts man. You know, that's part of what we want to see happening. And the best way we think we can do that is to divide and conquer and to streamline things and to empower people to do, instead of us thinking we have to do everything ourselves, beginning to grow that leadership base that makes it possible for more people to get involved over the next year. And so you're going to see a lot of things going on. Hopefully, everything will not take as long as it did to get this room painted, but in the process, we'll streamline some things. So what is our vision? What is it that God's wanting to do in the life of Community Church, and I believe ultimately in this area and even beyond the reaches of our zip code? God's talked to us on several occasions that He would send as many people here as we were prepared to minister to. So often we look around and we have the ability to house a lot more people than we have the ability to minister to. We can hold more people than what we can love effectively. And when I say love effectively, I'm not talking about that we can put our arms around them and smile and tell them we're glad to see them. I'm talking about kingdom kind of love that will help them become what God's called them to be. And so you're going to see a lot of effort placed in getting us on one page and allowing us to kind of streamline that effort of making sure that we can help people become what God created them to be. And you'll hear me talk a whole lot about a with God life. I know for my life, there was the life before my relationship with God and then the after relationship with God. And I'll tell you, I picked the one afterward every time. But I wouldn't have known that. Well, maybe you were like me, and maybe we're not doing like the people we're trying to reach. That I remember hearing preachers preach, or evangelists, or even Brother David, and my heart pounding out of my chest that the Holy Spirit was saying, come on, I want you. Go down front, pray with somebody, and I'd go through all the things I'd be losing in order to be a Christian. And so I sit in my seat, the pounding would go away, and I would go and wind my merry way of being a heathen. Then I'd come back to church and visit with somebody, and my heart would start pounding again. See, my heart knew where home was and was excited about the potential of getting home. And yet, my mind was programmed to see serving God as giving life up. And for many years, I carried that into my Christian walk. I carried into the walk with Christ that I gave up a lot to follow Him. And I wanted to please Him, and I wanted to live right. And I even made some rules for my life, and I even made rules for other people's lives. They may not have liked it or not, but I made them for them too, to help them live right. But I really kind of thought many times that my unsaved friends were really living, but I was going to go to heaven one day. And I began to discover that that's a bad way to look at serving God. Because somewhere we see that we have to take Jesus at His word. And His word in John 10:10, you've heard it spoke many times. What did the thief come to do? Steal, kill, and destroy. But what did Jesus come to do? To give life. What kind of life? An abundant one. And I asked myself, am I settling for less than an abundant life? And I had an answer to that. Yes, I was. See, somewhere in the process of my heart pounding for home, I began to see my heart settling down and my mind defining what it meant to be a Christian, what it meant to be saved, and it very little of it involved life. A lot of rules, some fear, some love, but a whole lot of rules. And somewhere, life got lost in the rules. And I began to realize I was carrying that even, not only into my walk, but into my ministry. And I almost found myself at some time apologizing. It was easy to share my faith with someone that their life is a wreck. It's like, dude, he's going to help you. Your life's a mess. But what about those people that look like they were having fun? I was like, well, come to Jesus. You're going to have to change a whole lot. And it's not going to be as fun, but you're going to get to heaven one day. And I didn't use those words, but I kind of did. And so this process is about helping us as a community of believers, as a family of the faith, to sing what we believe to be an abundant life, a with God life, that we can share from the youngest of our children to the oldest person, most more mature person we would invite, to talk to them about our faith and living in Christ. And the with God life is a life that's abundant and full of joy and full of peace and full of life, the way Jesus described it. And so you'll hear us talk a lot about that. What we want to accomplish through small groups at every level is to communicate that truth. Help people discover a life with God that's the best life possible. It's not the one they're settling for, because one day they'll get heaven. But today, right now, the best life possible. And the question becomes, how do we share that with the adults? Well, how do we share that with the kids? Well, how do we share that with teenagers? Well, what do we do? What should a small group look like to enable this? How much training should you and I go through in order to be able to do that effectively? Where should the lines be? And when we spend so much time meeting that we could have in life anywhere else. I mean, these are all the things we have to struggle with as we go through it. So over the next year, you're going to help me with this. Because there's going to be times that we're going to have to look at what we offer as a body. What the meetings we have, the times of worship we have, the schedule we keep, and ask ourselves, are we doing what God's called us to do the most effective way? And I believe there's going to be a point that we're going to come to a consensus that there may be times that we pass over good to get to better. And we might pass over better to get to best. But that's going to mean that we're going to have to be able to distinguish between the two. And so when you come to these meetings, please don't come just prepared to sit and listen. Come prepared to interact, to challenge, to ask the hard questions, to ask, Pastor, is this the most effective way to fulfill the vision God's given you, God's given us for this body? Because unless we can answer that, we're not prepared to move forward. And I know that there's going to come a time when we're going to have to come to good and say, that is good. It's had a great history with us. And say, yeah, but to get the better, we're going to have to say, good has its place, but it's not better. And what's going to happen at that point is a vision's going to have to take over. I believe that's where vision gives us the points to look at to give us the destination we desire. So what is the vision of community church? What is the vision that God's birthed in our hearts for what he has for us? I can tell you over the next year, we're going to end up raising some money. Because part of the vision is I want to have a world-class training center for our children's ministries. Okay? And I'm not saying that pie in the sky. I'm telling you, I believe God is placing the people in place for us to have a world-class training place for our children. And we are not there right now. So we're going to have to pass over better to get the best. We're going to have to restructure. We're going to have to build some things. To let you know, there's an architect meeting right now. We've got him on retainer. He started drawing up plans. And we envision coming into this large commons area looking completely different. And inviting us to go to a place where we turn it into where there's a children's department that screams, we value kids. Well, what does that mean? As a ministry team, we have to work together in a brand new way that we've never worked together before. As a church, we have to send funds in a direction that we've never really sent a whole lot of funds before. I want you to know that right now, give you an example, up till this year, our preschool birth through five-year-olds has ministered in a 12-month cycle for less than $12,000, at times $7,000. That's not much money if you want to be world class, is it? And when I say world class, I'm not saying someone will be better than anybody else. I'm saying because I believe that's what God's called us to. And so we're going to have to spend more money there. We're not going to want to walk down hallways where the floor's rolling up. You can't have a world-class training center where people are tripping over themselves. And so those things will be going on. There's going to be a place and time where the staff is going to have to relocate, and we won't be in offices anymore. We'll be in hallways meeting for a little while. Well, my vision is not to have offices and hallways, but I'll do what I have to do, and our staff will do what it has to do to fulfill what God's called us to. And He never called us to have nice offices. He called us to minister to our kids. And so that's what you're going to see on that next year. Guess what? We're going to count on you to be a part of that process, to understand where we're trying to go, and the sacrifice that it may take to get there, and the faith it may require to share it with people beyond this room. We'll be looking at continuing a brand new ministry you'll see coming up in August called Route 56 or something along that line. I call it Route 56 because I don't know any better. I don't know the name of it yet. It's for fifth and sixth graders. Right now, do you know when a kid decides what kind of person they want to be? Now, our vision is to train people up so they can walk in their destiny with a God life. Most people decide what kind of person they're going to be in life in fifth and sixth grade, somewhere in there. Well, guess what? Right now we have fifth graders with first graders, so they're frustrated. We have sixth graders with 12th graders, so they're scared to death. And so we take kids that are trying to figure out who they want to be and put them in the weakest possible place. And we're wondering why. Some kids are going, "I'll just stay home today, Mom." But guess what? We're going to do it differently. We're going to have a ministry built around them where they can galvanize their values in the strongest possible place together with trained leaders. Well, guess what you're doing tonight? We're going to be doing some training. And not all the training is exciting. But when we set a young man or young woman, adult down with fifth and sixth graders that are deciding what kind of people they're going to be for the rest of their lives, I don't want Johnny come late. I want a trained individual there that will be able to hear and pull out. Not to just tell them what to do, but to hear who God has called them to be, decipher through it, and lift them up to what God's called them to be. That doesn't happen by happenstance. That doesn't happen just because you want it to. That happens because people are doing what you're doing, sitting in training. But guess what? Dennis Powell and I can't do all the training. Dan Brack and Joshua and Risa and Matt can't do all the training. You're going to be trainers. You're here to be trained to have levels of leadership that people can count on. So part of our vision is to have this world-class training facility for our children and for our fifth and sixth graders. Well, that's going to move into our junior high and senior high and college and career. We want to have an intern program. You're going to be hearing over the next year that the staff is laying out 1- and 2-year plans. Not just for budgets, but we have to figure this out. See, right now, if we get an intern, you're going to have two people not knowing what they're doing.
What are you going to do today? I don't know. I was trying to figure out what I'm doing today. What are you doing?
So what does that require of us as a staff? We can't be lazy. I do not have a vision for a lazy staff. I don't know where that would come from. We're going to have a staff that's planning our tomorrows and our next months and our next years, so that when we bring on interns, we know what we need them to accomplish. We know how to position them to become what God's called them to be, and that they get to help in the ministry of them. So our staff, now I kind of exaggerated there, our staff knows more than I don't know what you're doing today, but we're getting further and further and further along. So our vision is to have that.
Well,
guess what else our vision is to do? To be able to create not only a facility that houses that, but to begin to send people out. So you're going to hear a lot about missions and mission work. Well, guess what? God has opened up doors for us everywhere we've been to say, hey, we want more. And you know what? Sometimes when we look in the mirror long enough, we start seeing the imperfections in our complexion and stuff. Well, I want you to know, you may look in the mirror and see the complexion of community church and at times be disappointed. But when we share with other people, they look at community church and say, please, show us how you're doing. We want to be that. And it's not because we're the most organized place in the world, but I believe we've inherited an intimacy with God and a desire for His presence and a genuine love for one another that is contagious and people are seeking that out. And so when I talk about doing all those other things excellently, it's because we are already able to build a foundation of love, honor, respect. And so we're going to keep championing those things and seeing that come to fruition. And so this vision begins to push us forward and begins to dictate where our staff grows. It begins to dictate what kind of teachings we have. It begins to dictate what kind of building we have. Part of what we want to see is, you know, some people like or dislike the colors. Please don't comment on that right now. But we had some people come in and give us some ideas about what the colors should be. Because I said this, I want people to walk through those front doors and feel this. I'm at home. I want them to feel warm. I want them to sit and talk long. I want them to be able to stay after church on Sunday and sit down on a nice chair. Not a hard one that says, get up, you're taking our spot. But a nice soft one that says, stay, sit a while, let's visit. And maybe Sunday after church we come out and there's a little cafe right there. And they sit down and they have a little pressed grape sandwich and a soda. And they sit there until 2:30, maybe 3, talking about the things of God in their lives and getting a meal. And before long, they might just wake up and say, hey, let's just go ahead and stay here because we'll be coming back for services in another 30 minutes anyhow. But create an environment that people want to be involved and stay a part of. Can you see yourself walking into a place that's warm and inviting, where people, there's signs and they're able to know where they're going, to navigate well throughout the building, to drop their kids off in a place where they trust the well-trained adults that are supervising their kids and talking to them about Jesus, and they come and they experience God's presence and worship, they see His power displayed in their lives, and they go back and pick up their kids and they hear from their kids what they learned that day, and they drive home talking about the things of God as a family. I can see that. I can see where God's called us to that. And I know that we can begin to build toward that end. But guys, guess what? That doesn't come because we have a great Sunday morning service with good preaching, good worship. Everything I describe happens on this side of those doors. Imagine that. Now, I can get up there and preach, and I hope I can hold your attention for 30, 40 minutes. But the real issue is, do you feel equipped to equip other people to reach out and love people so that they want more of a life with God? Do you feel equipped to, when we send people into your small groups, that you're able to sit there and facilitate a discussion? When one person's talking too much, you have the skill to kind of navigate around that. When the quiet one's in the corner and they won't open up, that you've got the skills to go over and elicit out of them where they come alive because now someone values what they have to say. Do you have the training you need when a husband and wife come to you and say, hey, we're hurting, we're struggling? Have you been given the tools? Not to just think you have the things to tell them, but to know you've got the flashlight in the dark. Walk with me. I'll get you home. That's why we're here. God has called us to a time such as this. He's called us to partner together in ministry and to begin to share new things. I've told you several months ago that as we do new things in ministry, you'll be the first to hear about it. The staff, the board, and the small group leaders. You've noticed that this room is growing. Dennis alluded to that a little bit. Why do we want more people in here? Why do we want the people that are dealing with small groups from the children to the adults together? Because we want to be on the same page. Because guess what? There's kids that talk and dominate conversations. And there are other kids that don't talk and feel like they're unimportant. But they need the same skills. And there's adults that haven't found their way in life and don't know which way is up spiritually. And there's kids that haven't found their way in life yet either. My heart longs to create a body of believers that having arrived, that's not the goal, but that God can trust souls with. I want to be in that place that God says, I don't just trust you to get them saved, to pray the prayer. I trust you to make disciples of them, to make genuine followers the way I would have done. I don't believe God's real interested in people praying prayers, but I believe He's extremely interested in people following Him. following Him in every aspect of life. I'd like to give just a moment for our staff to share how their vision and their heart reflects the things that I've talked to you a little bit about, that vision of training and reaching for the next level. Now notice, I didn't talk about reaching the world yet. I believe that's out there. I didn't talk about having this place overrun with so many people. We're having to do overflow services. I believe that's out there. But first things are first. Strengthen the foundation so I can handle the building. I'm going to start with Joshua. Joshua, would you come up here and share a little bit about how your heart is reflected here?